The makers of X-Lax present Strange as It Seems. Do you know that if the 46 million boxes of X-Lax that were used in America alone last year were piled one on top of the other, they would reach more than 116 times higher than Mount Fujiyama, the highest mountain in Japan? What an amazing record for one product to achieve. Or should we say, what an amazing product to achieve that record. Either way, there are good reasons for it. To begin with, X-Lax is as mild and gentle as a laxative should be. And yet, for all its mildness, it is thoroughly and completely effective. Then, too, X-Lax is so delightful to take. It tastes like the finest, most delicious chocolate. It is this rare combination of qualities that has made X-Lax the largest seller in the whole wide world. So when you or any member of your family needs a laxative, won't you try X-Lax and find out just how good, how pleasant it is, and how inexpensive, too? It is only 10 cents a box at any drugstore.
The man who solved his own crime. Paris, 1832. Francois Vidocq, ex-criminal and stool pigeon, is now employed by the Paris police. He is bored with his honest livelihood. The police admit his genius for detective work, but are not sure of his loyalty. In vain does Vidocq ask for more exciting work. Crime alone thrills him, brings out the genius within him. Francois Vidocq sits with a friend in a cafe in Montmartre. They speak in low tones, for Vidocq is unfolding a daring scheme.
As you can see, Charles, my plan will either make me the most famous detective of the Sûreté, or it will break me forever.
You are a genius, my dear Francois, a genius. But these perfect crimes are sometimes too perfect.
Zut! Nonsense. This one cannot fail. I've worked out every move, just like pawns on a chessboard. Ah, it will be sublime to commit a great crime. And then when the police are hopelessly baffled, I come forward with an offer to solve it.
Vidocq, I will help you. Allons, tell me once again what we are to do.
Naturally, Charles. You are the nominal head of the plan.
Agreed. Continue.
Eh bien. The Duc de Chaulieu lives in a simple chateau near Versailles. Most people do not think he's very well off, but I know better. I know that inside the fireplace, there is a secret passage. The passage leads to a room. Within that room is a desk. Inside the desk is a large paperweight shaped like a crouching lion. You press the left eye of the lion, a panel slides open, and what do you find?
Tell me quickly, Francois. I am on fire to know.
A necklace of emeralds.
Emeralds?
Everyone perfect. Think of it. 25 perfect emeralds.
Mon Dieu, mon Dieu. When shall we do this, Francois? Tonight? Tomorrow?
Not until the plan is well laid. First, give me your hand, Charles.
Voila.
Ah, bon. Now that I know you're with me, the rest is simple.
One question, Francois. What am I to get from this?
When I undertake to return the emeralds to the Duc de Chaleur, I will only find half of them. You understand?
I understand.
A month later, the office of the chief of the Paris detectives has a distinguished visitor, the Duc de Chaleur.
You must find my emeralds, monsieur. You must. My family has never been without them for 600 years.
Monsieur le Duc, we will do our best. But I confess that up to now we are completely baffled.
Tiens! I am the only person alive who knew of the existence of that necklace. And yet, in the dead of night, someone enters my house, knows the secret of the paperweight, removes the emeralds, and with matchless impudence places the paperweight on the table.
An organized gang has done this, Monsieur Le Duc.
Oh.
And there is only one man who knows the underworld well enough to solve this crime. That man is Francois Vidocq.
Put him on the case. Expense is nothing. I would mortgage my life for the return of those emeralds.
We will do our best, Monsieur Le Duc.
Très bien. Au revoir. I will await your next move with deep anxiety.
Verne. Joseph Verne.
You called me, monsieur?
Oui. Verne, I'm going to put Vidocq on the missing emeralds case. But I want him shadowed continually.
Why Vidocq? You know he cannot be trusted.
The thief was so anxious for his crime to be discovered that he deliberately placed the paperweight where Monsieur Le Duc would see it. In fact, you might almost think that the thief wanted the crime discovered. Why?
Possibly because he wished to prove himself superior to the police.
Exactly. Do you still wish to know why I place Vidocq on the case?
No. I am beginning to understand very well.
Several weeks pass. Then one day, Vidocq is called before the chief to tell of his progress with the case of the missing emeralds.
By your face, Vidocq, I can see that you are near the end of the trail.
Ah, mais oui. And I do not mind saying it's been the most difficult assignment of my entire career.
Your last assignment, Vidocq?
Huh? I thought I was doing my best. You cannot say that any other detective has made as much progress.
If all the detectives committed their own crimes, life would be a comparatively simple matter for the Paris police.
I do not follow you, monsieur.
Unfortunately, I have checkmated you. Vidocq, I have had you shadowed from the moment that you were assigned to the case. I have seen you slowly and with matchless cunning unravel the knot you so brilliantly tied. It's been an example for us all. But it is the end of you, Francois Vidocq.
Ah, non, de Dieu. I should not have left that paperweight on the table.
Vidocq, you have disgraced the police force. You've cost the city thousands of francs and have wrecked the peace of mind of a decent, law-abiding citizen. For these crimes, you are dismissed.
Dismissed?
Never again can you hope to hold a decent position. Go back to the sewers and the dives of the Apache. Back to the gutter, Vidocq. That is your real home.
Strange as it seems, Francois Vidocq actually did attempt to commit a perfect crime and then solve it for the Paris police. After he had been dismissed, he led a miserable existence and finally died in abject poverty. Strange, incredible, but true. The actor who played death too well. Theodore Roosevelt once said that it was better to wear out than to rust out. Most great men and women want to die with their boots on. The divine Sarah Bernhardt longed to be able to say her last words on the stage. Very few actors have been able to realize this wish, but one did. And that actor was the great Henry Irving. It is Friday, October the 13th, 1905. The town of Bradford, England, is the scene of great excitement. The wonderful old actor Henry Irving is honoring the city with his matchless performance of Thomas à Becket in Lord Tennyson's magnificent play, Becket. Although tired and sick, Irving still obeys the one commandment of the theater. The show must go on. On the stage, the fifth and last act of the great play is underway. Thomas à Becket, Archbishop of Canterbury, is waging a losing battle with the enemies of the Catholic Church. Henry II, King of England, was once his friend. Now he is his enemy, because Becket refuses to pardon some bishops who are friends of the king. Some hot-headed nobles decide to rid England of the great archbishop. have planned his assassination. The scene is the crypt of Canterbury Cathedral. Offstage, the choir can be heard. Beckett stands halfway up a flight of 20 steps and faces his would-be murderers.
I am he ye seek. What would ye have of me?
All like your life.
Say that ye absolve the bishop.
Never, except they make submission to the church. You've had my answer to that cry before.
Why, then you are a dead man, please.
I will not. I am readier to be slain than thou to slay. Hugh de Morville, I know well thou hast but half a heart to bathe this sacred pavement with my blood. God pardon thee in these, but God's full curse shatter you all to pieces if ye harm one of my flock.
I make him prisoner. Do not harm the man.
Strike him, Tracy. Strike
him. Oh, noble knights, strike your own archbishop in his own cathedral. Ye will die the death of dogs.
Answer not, but strike.
Here is my answer, then. My sword.
Oh, at the right hand of power, power and great glory. For thy church, O Lord, into thy hands, O Lord, into thy...
Great actor Henry Irving could not come before the curtain and acknowledge the tremendous applause. For his life, like Archbishop Beckett's in the play, was at an end. Strange as it seems, Beckett's last words, "Into thy hands, O Lord, into thy hands," were also Henry Irving's last words on the stage. That night he died, as he had wished, with his boots on. X-Lax just must be a better laxative to judge by the world's opinion of it, because more X-Lax is used than any other product of its kind in the whole wide world. Just think, in America alone, there were 46 million boxes used last year. What an achievement! What a record for one product to make. But the reasons behind it are easy enough to understand. To begin with, X-Lax is as mild and as gentle as a laxative should be. And yet, for all its gentleness, it is thoroughly and completely effective. Then, too, it is so delightful to take. Imagine, it tastes just like the finest, most delicious chocolate. If you don't know how pleasant and agreeable it is, then try X-Lax the very next time you or any member of your family need a laxative. It is so very inexpensive, too. Just 10 cents a box at any drugstore. You may be able to wear a beard now if you want to, but in the old days in Russia, no man could wear a beard. Listen to our next broadcast. You will also witness the race of two sailors in 15-foot dories all the way from New Bedford, Massachusetts, to England. You have just heard Strange as It Seems by John Hicks, directed by Cyril Armbrister. Butterflies taste with their feet.